Let me tell you something. Again, there's not a moment of it that is wasted or goes over my head, because to see what this show has done, and not just for the queer artists and the queer community, but for people who never felt that they had a place where they belonged, they see themselves represented. If it were 12-year-old me or 13-year-old me who was bullied and had no friends, and I had a show like RuPaul's Drag Race, I would not feel alone.
Drag Race UK versus the world, it's really good. Because you judge it, you judge our one, you do America, you do the All-Stars, you do
Down Under.
Like, do you have to kind of, in your head, is it a hard job? Do you have to really concentrate and kind of go, I must keep paying attention? Because it must sort of become kind of drag snow blindness after a while.
You know what? I love it so much. I loved, before Drag Race was even a thing, and I was growing up on the mean streets in New York City, drag was an obsession of mine. I just loved it. I didn't know why. There was just something I connected to, the fantasy of it all. So for me, it's like sitting down with my closest friends and watching the greatest show on earth every single day. I do not take it for granted. I do not ever get in a point where it becomes snow blindness to me. I love it so much and I take it so serious. You see me sitting there writing down. I'm constantly picking and noting, and I just love it, and I love what they do.
No, because it makes me laugh, because when we're doing the critiques, when me and Alan speak, it could be bird song. They are not paying any attention to what we're saying at all. When you and Rue speak, they're like, and they are listening. Because what you say is brilliant.
And what you say and what Alan says is brilliant as well.
It's just filler.
So I don't agree.
It is. It really is.
I don't agree.
At the end of the series, if you ask any of the queens, can you say anything that Alan or Graham said to you, they will not remember anything.
Oh, I disagree.
Everything you said, they'll remember.
Oh, go on then.
No, they will.
I don't necessarily agree.
And do you, because then you work with them afterwards.
Yes.
That's the thing. I never see them again. So I can say whatever I like. But you work with them. You do the tours and stuff.
Yeah.
Do they ever come up to you and do they ever have an issue with things you've said?
Some of them have said, but we always end up laughing about it. And they always understand what I'm saying. And I'm sure you've been the same way, and I've been the same way in all of my career with the critiques that I've gotten, especially being a female in radio. The critiques over the years have been like, what? You know, and they need to make sense. And then when you're in it, you don't want to hear it. But after you're removed, then you understand it. So I think it's more about that than it is in the moment, because it does hurt the tummy when you're in it, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Nobody wants to hear they're too this, or they're not good enough or whatever. Yeah. And when it's done, you go, oh, okay, they were probably right. I have to acquiesce.
And also what's amazing, I think, is to see what happens to the ones who do listen.
Oh, you know what happens. Success. We are as good as our failures. Do you know what I mean? That's how we learn. If we don't fail, we don't learn. So how do we get better? How do we improve? By failing.
Yeah.
That's it.
And you must, because when did you join the Drag Race family in America?
Series 3.
Oh, wow. So, oh my God. So you've been doing it for 13 seasons.
Yeah. 13 years. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
And so 13 years later, even you must be surprised at what's happened to Drag Race.
Are you kidding me? When it started and they offered, season one was offered to me, and I'm going to tell you what happened in 2 seconds. I was in a radio contract for it was a 5-year deal. I was in year one and the boss said basically no. So I couldn't do it. He wouldn't let me out even for 2 weeks to film. So it became very, very complicated. And then when they asked me for series 3 and they said no again, I went to the big president of the company and said, please. And they said, okay. So for me, it was just a little show on a little network, which was Logo Television. Yeah. It was a very gay network. It's a little engine that could, and we just loved what we did. We were a big, giant family just rallying for these artists that deserved some kind of platform.
Yeah.
And seeing it slowly grow and slowly grow and slowly grow to what it is today, there's not a minute where I don't have to pinch myself to realize this is a landscape and game changer for these queer artists. It's pretty amazing.
Because if you look back at some of those early series, I mean, it looks like it was filmed in Rue's garage.
100%.
And then you're all at the Emmys.
It's unbelievable. And let me tell you something. Again, there's not a moment of it that is wasted or goes over my head, because to see what this show has done, and not just for the queer artists and the queer community, but for people who never felt that they had a place where they belonged, they see themselves represented. If it were 12-year-old me or 13-year-old me who was bullied and had no friends, and I had a show like RuPaul's Drag Race, I would not feel alone. And that's what this show does. And that's the impact of it.
I know, it was really special. At the, I went to DragCon last year. I just finished this year. But to see the audience, because you never get to see a TV audience.
Right.
But at that, you see who's watching the show. And it's so lovely because it's across the board.
Diversity everywhere. Yeah. Ages, classes, race, you name it. Everybody is represented. Everybody is loved. Everybody's welcomed and adored.